Hey, 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 and welcome to another episode of the Crew Podcast. I am your visionary, Queen Angela. And if you are a diva that's looking to amplify your voice and you're looking for a home, we have space for you. Come on over and join them divas of Yahweh and amplify your voice.
Dallas Fort Worth, AALAC, the Chasing Your Dream Book Tour and Expo is coming to your area. Mark your calendars May 18th, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central Standard Time. We have some amazing authors, some amazing business owners that's going to be sharing about their brand. We have some workshop facilitators that's going to be coming out. They're going to be teaching on branding, marketing, and networking. I want you to plan to be in the building, to be educated, empowered, and encouraged. Come out, support.
Aspiring Authors Magazine is a founding sponsor for Da Crew Podcast. Get featured inside the magazine and allow your voice to be heard around the world.
Aspiring Authors Magazine is an international magazine founded in May of 2020 by Queen Angela. Get featured.
At Wings of Transformation Publishing, we are committed to helping our authors reach their goals and pursue their dreams of becoming published authors. We work closely with each author to ensure a successful publishing experience, and we are dedicated to helping them tell their stories in the most meaningful and impactful ways. We look forward to putting you on the path to writing your book.
All things ain't what they used to be now. Where did all the blue skies go? Poison is the wind that blows from the north and south and east. Oh, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be now.
Tune in to Delay But Not Deny every second Monday and fourth Friday of each month. This is the show that you don't want to miss.
Good evening, good evening, good evening, and welcome to another episode of Delay But Not Deny, the podcast. I am your host, Latonya Littlejohn. Tonight we will be talking about disabilities and gaslighting. Stay with me because I'm going somewhere with it. But before I begin, I would like to read to you this Bible verse. It says, "Do not curse the deaf or put a stumbling block in front of the blind, but fear your God. I am the Lord." Leviticus 19 and 14. The Apostle Paul later echoed this sentiment in a passage that compared Christ's church to the human body. The eye cannot say to the hand, "I don't need you." So what I wanted to discuss is my disability. I was born with spina bifida, and for those who don't know what that is, spina bifida is when a baby's spine and spinal cord does not develop properly in the womb, causing a gap in the spine. Spina bifida is a type of neural tube defect. The neural tube is the structure that eventually develops into the baby's brain and spinal cord. Also, you know, dealing with hydrocephalus, which is fluid on the brain. I'm sharing this tonight because oftentimes if people can't see your disability, they assume that you don't have one or it's not as bad, quote unquote, as some other people's disabilities that can be seen, which brings me to gaslighting. Gaslighting is making someone seem or feel unstable, irrational, and not credible, making them feel like what they're seeing or experiencing isn't real. They're making it up, that no one else will believe them. Gaslighting involves an imbalance of power between the abuser and the person they're gaslighting. So, with that being said, I just want to talk about how it's easy to come at somebody, you know, about not showing up for themselves and not being able to do what you think that they should be doing based on what you know of them. And, you know, living with spina bifida, I have good days, I have bad days, I have ups, I have downs. I am not one to push myself. I'm not going to ever push myself to a breaking point to prove strength to someone else. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, a lot of people can do that. And, you know, I salute them, but I can't. If I'm down, I'm down. I mean, that's just what it is. I have instances where I'm awake for 2 and 3 days at a time, where my brain sends off signals saying that we've slept, ma'am. We're good. But in reality, my body has not touched the bed because I'm up. I can't sleep. Different doctor's appointments. I've been in and out of hospitals all my life. I'm 45 years old, and I've had more surgeries than I can count on both hands. Also, with spina bifida came along calcium and vitamin D deficiency. And where I'm going with that is how I'm sitting in front of you right now with no teeth in my mouth. The lack of vitamin D and calcium is what you need to have strong, healthy teeth. Me lacking those things is why I don't have any. Sure, you know, people can use the false teeth, whatever. And I do have some, but they don't make me who I am. So I don't always put them in. And I still show up for myself when I can. And I say that to say that, you know, oftentimes with spina bifida, it's a day-to-day change. Like, you don't know what tomorrow is going to be like, let alone 5 minutes from now. Like, right now, I am perfectly fine. I can't say that I'll be perfectly fine in the next hour or so. And that's not speaking bad on myself. It's just one of those things that goes along with it. There has been bullying in my life behind the spina bifida. I quit school because of the spina bifida. Being picked on for something that I have no control over is one of the worst feelings ever. Like, you know, you can try to explain to people what you're going through and telling them, you know, how you feel. And to some people, it may look like excuses or sound like excuses, but when you're living in it, you can't tell one person, you know, that what they're feeling is not what they're feeling, because that's them. You know what I'm saying? You can't put yourself in a situation. The whole little term of walk in their shoes, walk a mile in their shoes, you can't. You can't. It's not that easy to do that. I'm going to have my husband come and chat with me about what it's been like living with me for the last 25 years, well, dealing with me, excuse me, for the last 25 years. We only been married 22. But dealing with me and everything that I have to go through with spina bifida. So, Rico, if you don't mind, come and join me. How are you?
Good.
So, I asked you to join me tonight because it's my spirit led me to do this show tonight to talk about my spina bifida and things of that nature, because a lot of people don't understand just what it entails and what I'm dealing with from day to day. And, you know, a lot of people would say that I make excuses and I don't show up for myself and it hurts. It hurts my feelings. Because I know what I'm dealing with. Right. You know what I'm saying? Right. I've never been one to push myself to the max, because if I do, then that tears away at an already, you know, non-functioning body sometimes. Right. So, you know, I want to ask you, what it's been like.
Well, I'm going to tell you, first off, I didn't really see it when we were dating.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see that because, you know, when we spent time, it would be the weekends.
Right.
And majority of the time when we spend together, it's only a few hours
mm-hmm.
to take you home.
Right.
I started experiencing that when we first got married.
Okay.
When we started, like, being together.
Right.
You know, waking up, going to bed together.
Mm-hmm.
All right. First off, I didn't, like, really get it. And until you really had to, like, you know, it's just basically experiencing things little by little.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? With the headaches.
Mm-hmm.
With the, when you showed me the shunt.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? I was like, you know, when you showed me the shunt and when you was like, well, there's a scar right here and it goes all the way down my neck.
And the bottom half is in the valve behind my heart.
Yeah. See, we didn't really know that at first.
Right. We thought it drained down into my stomach. Yeah.
And so until you had the x-ray.
Right.
But when you showed me the scar, I was like, you know, really want to know what does the purpose of a shunt means.
Right.
And you told me that, and you showed me a diagram of how it functions,
mm-hmm.
of where it's placed, how it works. Okay. Then with the excess fluid on your brain, it goes through, you know, it exits.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? How you urinate.
Mm-hmm.
And it may not be actual, you know.
Yeah.
Pee.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It could be
fluid. Yeah.
You know, and that's why you had, at the time, pads.
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder why you wore pads all the time.
Right.
So, found that out. And when you had started having your periods.
So with the cycle, with my cycle, because of, it's more so the hydrocephalus
with that.
I developed endometriosis.
Right.
And that would cause my cycle to come on and stay.
Right.
Like, set up shop, not leave.
Right, for several weeks.
To months.
To a point you have to go to the doctor,
mm-hmm.
and they try to figure out what's going on.
All right.
You know, and at times you kept pads.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they were like, you know.
I had stocking always.
Yeah, stocking, yeah.
I swear I did. Yeah. I could have been the poster girl for always, because.
Yeah, and it got to a point where you had to visit a doctor. For your period, for the operation?
Well, before that, I had to have the blood transfusions.
Right.
Well, back up. Before that, they put me on iron pills.
Right.
Because my iron, I have an iron deficiency.
Right.
Iron is always low. Even now. They put me on the iron pills. They made me sick. They went to the injections.
Right.
Those didn't work.
Those didn't work.
And then, so I started getting
the blood transfusion.
The infusions
right.
for the iron. And that worked until it didn't.
Right.
I remember having to go to the cancer center,
right.
to the Gibbs Cancer Center, and sit amongst those people fighting for their lives. And I had to be amongst them to receive those treatments.
Right.
And I did that for a couple of months. And one time in particular, they didn't give me the fluid that they would give me before they started my treatment. And I went outside to wait on you because
right.
you were at work.
Yeah.
And usually I would set up my appointments to where you could drop me off.
Yeah.
And by the time I'm done, you're done from
yeah.
work.
Yeah.
And so this particular time I went outside, I was waiting on you. I started feeling lightheaded.
Right.
And I sat there and I was like, what is going on? And my blood pressure dropped.
Right.
And I wet myself like
right.
completely. Like,
I mean, you
that my body was shutting down.
Shutting down, yeah.
And I managed to get up and I walked to the door and I knocked on the door. And those glasses are soundproof.
Yeah.
I'm beating. That lady would not look around. And just so happened, another lady walked across and she opened the door. And when she opened the door, I fell in her arms.
Right.
And all I remember after that was her saying, stay with me. Don't go to sleep.
Right.
Keep your eyes open. And when you came to pick me up, I was still receiving whatever
yeah.
they were giving me to get me back going.
Yeah, and then told me that it's going to be a minute because of what happened.
Right.
And I waited. And basically waited until, okay, till you finish. And I was like, are you sure that she's able to, you know, go home and be all right? Do I have to, like, you know, take her to the hospital later on or
mm-hmm.
what have you? But, you know, that time and the time me and Deontay was in St. Louis. On a church trip.
And the crazy thing about that, I wasn't able to go because my cycle was on.
Right.
And it was bad.
Right.
And so I...
And it was a good thing that you didn't go because you'd have been up there in St. Louis.
In the hospital with no way home.
Because
y'all came back with the church.
Yeah, because we'd have to... Basically, me, you, and Deon, if you had went with us
mm-hmm.
and that happened, they basically would have left us there.
Mm-hmm.
And we probably, I don't know.
Yeah.
If we had to basically
fly home.
Or
get somebody to come pick us up.
Yeah.
With that being said, the day that I went to the hospital, I was feeling weak.
Yeah.
And I could hear my heartbeat, not just by putting my hand on my heart
yeah.
and feeling it. I could hear it.
Yeah.
I could hear doo-doo. And it scared me. And so I managed to get myself up and I walked next door and knocked on our neighbor's door.
Right.
And I asked her if she could take me to the hospital. I told her she didn't have to stay. I'd find a way back home.
Right.
And so she took me. And what I learned in that moment was that I had a miscarriage.
Right.
Didn't even know I was pregnant. Didn't know. And that's another thing that I've dealt with. I've had more miscarriages than I have children.
Right.
And I went in, they told me what it was. They said that they wanted to keep me.
Right.
Or whatever. I don't know who got in touch with you and Deontay.
Yeah, because by the time we got to Macedonia,
mm-hmm.
we got off the bus, and that's when my mom told us that you was at the hospital. So Deontay, not to worry about it, I got it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I came up, and you know, and made sure everything, what happened, what went on, blah blah. You know, to is finding out what went on.
So, right.
And that whole time, listening to the doctors, you know, that you had options. And at the time, you couldn't have.
My options were to get a hysterectomy, right, or to get my womb scraped, right, and my tubes tied and burned. They guaranteed me that that would work.
Yeah.
Something in my spirit said it would.
And
so I kept telling you, I was like, well, I wasn't telling you, I was telling the doctor.
But the doctor told you if you had the hysterectomy,
I would have died. You
bled to death.
I would have bled to death.
And died on the table. Operating table. So I was like, you know, he asked you, what did you want? And he was like,
I want the hysterectomy.
And I was like, yo, did you just hear what the doctor said?
Yeah.
You're going to get your groom scraped. You're going to do this XYZ and do that to see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
And it did. It worked for a little bit.
No,
it did work for a little bit.
Not as quite as they said it would.
Yeah,
right. Because weeks after that, it came back with the vengeance. Right. Like, you know, like it.
Yeah.
Was before.
And then you had to basically.
I had to wait. And build my blood, right, back up. Receiving other people, my heart goes out to,
and you said you can,
the blood donors.
You said
I will tell you, I could smell that blood, and that's the thought of it.
Like, what, really?
It had a smell, it had to smell it. To it. And then I don't know if that's a part of my paranoia. I'm looking at.
I've never had blood drawn or blood given, so I wouldn't. Yeah. I don't know.
I'm looking at these different pints of blood that they bring in one by one. Because that last time I had to have like six bags put in.
Because you lost so much.
That doctor said he did not know how I walked in there.
Right.
Like that. And, you know, I say all that to say, you know, they say to have mustard seed faith, and it's hard to trust and believe in God when you can't see him, but I know that he's next to the brokenhearted, and he knew if I could just hold on a little while longer.
But you know, have you ever seen the size of mustard
seed? They're small.
Real small.
But my faith in God was bigger than that. Like I knew he wasn't gonna let anything happen to me on that operating table. But I didn't want to go toe to toe with you because I was already feeling bad. And
but you have to understand on my part, my side,
and at that moment I wasn't thinking about
to
nobody but me.
Yeah, and you gotta understand you have a husband.
Yeah,
you have two kids.
Yeah,
and you have to feel that look. Being how many years were we in? We're not even five.
This was
not even 5 years.
2012. So, yeah, it was 10 years.
10 years.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was short. Wasn't longer than that. But being in 10 years in and losing a wife.
Yeah. Yeah, and I never stopped to think that only thing was for me was I don't want to never lose another baby.
Right.
I don't want to get another bag of somebody else's blood.
Right.
It was just too much. And a lot on my mental.
And on my end, it was just me losing a wife, Deontay and Deja losing a mother.
Yeah.
Especially Deontay.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Especially him. I felt more bad for him than me.
Yeah.
Because when bottom line, you were young when you had it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just you and him.
Yeah.
I felt bad for that.
Yeah.
And I was like, and I had a conversation with him. He asked me, I never told you this.
Mm-hmm.
He was like, is anything going to happen to my mother? I told him, I looked him dead in his eyes. No. I said, if left up to me,
mm-hmm,
nothing's gonna happen to you. So we're gonna do everything we can, and to get this right, basically, you know, get this right, and at least get you into a place where you don't have to worry about a period anymore.
All right. So May 15th, 2015, they brought me in and decided to do my hysterectomy.
Right.
In the beginning, I was sad because I was like, this is it. This means no more babies.
Right.
None. And, you know, I've always been the one to be like, because, you know, we got married. The Bible says be fruitful and multiply. And I was trying to multiply by two. But you know, it
what I looked at it.
It wasn't a part of God's plan.
What I looked at it, I gained a son. Mm-hmm. You gained a daughter.
Yeah.
That's where I looked at it.
Yeah.
So, and it was more keeping you here than anything.
Right.
You know, because like you said, you had so many operations, even with me, even married with, to me.
Oh my God. Like from my head to my feet, like, having foot surgery.
Foot surgery.
That was a wild ride. Because of having spinal bifida, I have a condition called club feet.
Yep.
Where that means that my little itty bitty toes, because my toes, most people's toes are average size. Some people got toes that look like fingers, but that's neither here nor there. My toes are like the size of a baby's toes. And with club feet, in between the toes, they stick together.
They're webbed.
They're, the skin connects them and whatever. So I had to have corrective surgery on my left foot because one of my toes was curled under and it was going under my
foot. The toe that's next to the big toe.
Mm-hmm.
It curled under like that.
And they told me surgery, with the fact that my weight fluctuates up and down, that
that one toe
could cause me to break all of my toes.
Could have your rest of your toes, the other three toes, to curl behind it, basically, you know.
Yeah.
And that would have been, you know.
Yeah.
You basically would have to have probably your toes empty there, if that happened.
That one, And so they put, I had to go to the hospital. They put a pin in all of my toes. Well, back up. They broke all my toes, put pins in every last one of them except the big one.
Yeah.
And they told you to allow me to be independent.
Right.
In my independence, I fell and bumped my head.
Yeah.
Because
at the time we were living in an apartment with stairs.
Yeah. I forgot all about the pain in my foot and was concerned more about my head.
Right.
But
was I there when I wasn't there with that?
Well, when I fell, it was just me.
Yeah.
You had went back to work.
Yeah.
And so you know, the doctor, I was trying to come down the stairs to go get something to eat.
Right.
And the crutches. That's why I stopped using those crutches.
Yeah.
I was supposed to crutch step. And the railing for those apartments, well, our apartment, it was already flimsy.
Yeah.
And so I lost my foot and then went head first.
Yeah.
But I say all that to say, you never know what people go through.
Right.
Didi said we got children feet. We really do. And that's the plus size, because the plus side of it all, because we can shop in the children's department and spend children prices on shoes. Whereas, you know, most people have to pay an arm and a leg for whatever, for adult sizes. Right. You know, I say all that to say, you know, stepping outside of your comfort zone is one thing. Pushing yourself to the limit to appease other people is something different, and something that I'm not willing to do.
Because
at the end of the day, all I got is me.
Right.
And, you know, dealing with all of this and going to therapy, trying to just get an understanding
of you,
of me, right, and why me.
Right.
And I know that God is using me for somebody else.
Right.
I didn't quite get that before.
Yeah.
Because the selfish me is like, okay, why does this have to be me? Why can't I, you know, wear regular underwear like most people? Like, I hate Victoria's Secret for the simple fact of you go in there to buy a bra and they force the panties down your throat. And I don't need those.
And what would with me
and having
the high heels with you?
Oh, yes. I love stilettos.
So I was like, every time like try some
Knowing heels, I can't walk in them. I can't stand up in them.
That's how I feel uncomfortable when you like, I like these. And you come walking out. I'm like, no.
And I mean,
breaking an ankle.
But that's a part of me.
Falling and breaking an arm or, you know, anything like that.
That's a part of me wanting to feel like, I can't say feel normal because I don't know what, you know, able-bodied people's normal is. I don't know what that's like. So I can't say.
What I've always told you.
Everybody got something going on.
Everybody got something going on.
Yeah.
Whether it's mentally, physically.
Yeah.
You know, everybody has something.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
And I mean, and I get that. I understand it. But.
Everybody has something.
You know, when you see people and you get, well, you should have called, or you could have did this, or you could have did that. In that moment, I couldn't.
Right.
And, you know, learning to show up for myself in a time such as this has been, it's been hard. Because, like, normally I tuck tail and just let people talk to me any kind of way, and that just be that. But in a way, I mean,
and
you know, it's sanctified bullying when people are.
I had to learn.
Yeah.
Because you put me.
Yeah, because I had to get you straight.
Yeah.
Because you used to feel like I was a hypochondriac.
Yeah, you can do it.
Yeah.
You can. You know what I'm saying? Until you put me in these groups, and I met some of the groups. You know, you were in a spinal bifida group where you met Dee Dee.
Mm-hmm.
He met other folk. And just basically learning from these hydro groups about how you sleep, how, you know, what you can eat, what you can't eat, because you can't eat too much because you get sick.
Right.
You can't, you know.
And there's times where I go days without days eating without because eating. I feel full. Yeah. Like, I mean.
There's days where, you know.
I just want people to get an understanding.
You'll stay up all night. I've experienced that too.
Mm-hmm.
You staying up for 2-3 days.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, have you had any sleep yet? And he was like, I'm not sleeping. But when you do go to sleep.
Oh, I'm out.
You're out.
Yeah,
you can sleep for at least
days.
4 days. Yeah.
Days.
You'll get up to use the bathroom, but you'll go right back to bed.
Yeah. And that's my norm.
And
it doesn't seem normal for people on the outside looking in, like.
And when you have those days when you do go to sleep, you don't sleep with a pillow half the time.
Yeah,
you sleep flat.
Flat on the mattress.
And I had to learn that from reading different people that's in those hydro groups, you know what I'm saying? Reading one guy who slept on the floor because he couldn't sleep in the bed because
The bed didn't feel right.
Didn't feel right.
Right.
He had to lay on the floor.
Right.
Flat on the floor, you know, due to the hydrocephalus, you know what I'm saying? And at the time, a while back, they were considering putting another shot in your head on the other side, on this side.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And it was a possibility, 50-50 chance
that it would work, and 50% chance that it wouldn't. And I just said that, you know, God has carried me for 45 years with this one. I'm not going through that again.
Right.
I'm not. And, you know, cards fall where they may. It's all, at the end of the day, it's all God's will.
Right.
And his will be done.
Even when you talk to Didi, you know, I'm hearing her, what she goes through.
Right.
You know, similar, but you're walking and she's in a wheelchair, but it's the same thing.
Same thing,
you know, and, you know, what she goes through is exactly what you go through.
And what I hate the most is hearing people say, oh, well, it could have been worse. Yeah, it could have. Yeah. It could have been better. I mean,
you know, and that's not.
That's not. It wasn't my call.
Yeah, it wasn't your call.
You know, that's all God's design. And I oftentimes question why God designed me this way. Why I'm not able to do certain things, but I've come to the conclusion that it just ain't meant for me. I mean, and that's cool. That's okay. That doesn't make me less than anybody else. It just makes me different. And
when you all, we all have to be different. That's God's design anyway, to be different. We all can't be the same. Because I'm telling you, if we were all the same, this planet would be bored. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because we're doing the same thing. We basically living the same way.
Right.
Driving the same way.
Yeah.
Eating the same way.
Yeah.
Running the same way. Doing things the same way. You know, it's just, you know, you got to understand that God put people in places to learn from each other.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we have different races.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We all, you know, only thing that's different about these races, you know, our color. That's it.
Yeah.
We all human. It's right. Just the color.
Yeah.
We all got the heart. We all got the lungs. We all got, you know, everything, you know, as human beings, but we all are built different.
Yeah.
We all have to go through life, you know.
In our own way.
In our own way. From the time we're born to the time we close our eyes.
Right. Trevita said disabilities are difficult for those who don't deal with one. It's also hard to understand. The ones that can't be seen makes it hard for people to believe. Also, they will say prayer, pray for complete healing. And oh my God, that's another one. So for me and only me, I say that, I do believe that God can heal me on this side. And I stand on that. Nobody can make me feel that I have to wait and die to go to heaven for me to be healed. I feel like, you know, God is using me in this moment to walk this walk. But he, you know, ultimately can change me. Like, I don't have to stay this way. And, you know, I mean, it's the bullying that bothers me more than anything.
But you know what about bullying is, right? You know, they're not comfortable with their selves, so they find a way to bully others, to make them feel good about themselves.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I feel about bullying.
Mm-hmm.
They have something, he or she has something going on,
mm-hmm.
you know, that makes them feel bad. You know what I'm saying? And they have to get that outlet of picking with somebody else.
Yeah.
That's their outlet.
Yeah.
To pick with.
And oftentimes, pick with people that, you know, a lot of
are
people
lesser than them, or, you know, they may not have money. You know what I'm saying? They may not live in a certain place.
Yeah.
They may not drive a certain car. You know what I'm saying? They may learn different.
Mm-hmm.
And they take that and run with it because right. they have something inside themselves that they're not good with, you know, they can't cope with.
Yeah.
That's all about bullying.
And then, I mean, there's a lot of bullying in Christianity as well.
There is.
And that's the sad thing for me. Just knowing that people can sit there and tell you what you can and can't do if you just push yourself. And, you know, God didn't tell me to do that. He didn't tell me to exude myself to the point of where I'm laid out looking.
Some people can do that.
I mean, yeah. I mean, some people can and some people can't.
It's depending on, like you said, how they're built. If they can do that, good for them.
I mean, some people built for it tough. I'm a pinto all day.
And if you're not, even if you're not comfortable with doing that,
yeah,
you don't have to.
And I understand, you know, there is situations where people get comfortable and not willing to try or whatever. But, you know, once you've tried and if it still don't work, you know, it's time to find another way, find another avenue.
Right.
Trevita said healing means something different to everyone. My belief is that I'm healed on this side according to God's design for my life. And I agree with that wholeheartedly. Like, I believe that my healing will come on this side, and I'll be able to enjoy life and the way that I visualize it to be in my mind. Like, right now, I am vicariously seeing life through the lenses of a three-year-old. If it had not been for Kay and the way she is with me, I don't think that I would ever get to where I am, like, right now, because, you know, I know that you love me. I know that the kids love me, but it's something about that grandbaby.
Grandbabies are different.
That
different type of love. You know what I'm saying?
She sees me for me. I mean, and, you know, I don't mind sharing all of me. I share all of me. So when Kay was potty training, we would put her in the pull-ups or whatever. And so anytime she had an accident or whatever, I'd tell her, you know, get your pull-up so we can go change or whatever. Because I have to wear pull-ups, she'll go grab my bag too. Like, we in this thing together.
Right.
You change yours, I'ma change mine, and that's going to be what it's going to be.
Right.
But she sees me.
Right.
She doesn't see spina bifida. She doesn't see hydrocephalus.
She sees you as Gigi.
She doesn't see the walk or whatever. Now, the only time I've actually thrown that baby off is, you know, 95% of the time I don't have my dentures in. And then sometimes, well, normally I would put them in for my podcast, but I was going somewhere with this one tonight, so they still would have it. Mm. But she looked at me, she said, "Gigi, who grabbed your teeth?" I said, "Nobody grabbed my teeth." And she went and told her daddy, "Gigi's teeth are gone." And so, you know, I had to explain to her that, you know, I had to have them pulled because my calcium and vitamin D deficiency.
And she'll understand it
as she get older. You know, I'm not expecting her to understand
3 years old.
But but for her to pay attention,
she's going to learn the way more. That she does. She's going to learn more about you than, you know, anybody will know.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And getting back to the religion thing, you know, we all sit up there and, you know, do God.
Sit high and look low. You
know what I'm we people that do.
But and that's the thing. We don't sit high enough to look down our noses at people.
You're not, who are we to judge?
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I can't judge you. You can't judge me. Only God can judge you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And, you know, prayer, you know, it works. You have to believe in it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You know, like I've told you before, I'm more spiritual than religion.
Right.
Religion starts wars.
Right. You know it does.
You know, different, you know, the Baptists and the Methodists, Catholics, all that. You know, all of them clash. All that clashes. And then man-made religion. You know what I'm saying? Don't get it twisted. Man-made religion.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're, you know what I'm saying, if you're in the Bible like you say you are, Jesus never carried a title.
Right.
He never carried a title.
Right.
He ran around healing folk, blessing folk, you know what I'm saying, and what have you. You know, Jesus never, you know, he came down here Because, you know, God was going to destroy this world. Yeah. He's going to destroy his planet. He did it once.
Yeah.
He's going to do it again.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
He but definitely wasn't going to do it. Let me go try to talk to these little raggedy people.
He stood forth and like, look, I'm going to go down here for these 33 years and do what I can to, you know,
bring a change
and, you know, let them know that you're God.
Yeah.
Because like I said, he brought a flood here. Mm. The next time was going to be fire. Mm-hmm. And God was going to bring fire. Mm-hmm. Until Jesus stepped in. Let me take the burdens. Let me take the sins of these people.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Do you know one man? Can you imagine one man taking the sins of the world?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Putting it on his back. You know what I'm saying? Being punished.
For something he didn't even do.
For something that, you know, God never intended. God was going to cleanse this world.
Yeah.
He's going to do it.
Yeah.
He's like, well, let me do that. Let me take that strife. You know what I'm saying? You know, being hung on a cross. You know what I'm saying? Having nails stuck in his hand and his feet.
And pierced in his side.
That's what killed him. The piercing in his side. Because, you know.
He bled out.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? That crucifixion is a Roman torture.
Yeah.
You understand? He was suffering. He was breathing until, you know, he had fluid in his lungs.
Yeah.
And basically, you know, to release that fluid, he had to be punctured in his side.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people, he died on the cross. He was tortured.
I just, my message tonight is just to, for people to think about their brother and their sister and what they may be going through. Just because you don't go through it doesn't mean that it's not happening. It indeed does happen.
This is all about caring.
Fellow man. Absolutely.
All about that. You know. If you got,
we gotta stop making people feel less than for things that are out of their control.
Right.
Because
I had to learn to.
Yeah. Because right. I mean. You know, that was something that we had to cross over because, you know, I stopped going to doctor's appointments because you kept saying that I was a hypochondriac until doctors were sitting there telling you, you know, this is what's going on. And nobody knows my body like I know my body. Other than
now,
God.
And now when you and you're hurting, I always ask you.
Yeah.
Is it to a point we have to go to the hospital? Or is it to a point where you can like manage it.
Right.
And if I feel like it's too much, we're going to the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's how I am now. I am now because I've learned, you know, how much pain you can endure, how much pain you can't. You know, I'm at this point now, I can tell that, you know, this pain is overbearing. Tonya, let's go. We got to go to the hospital. I'm saying,
because a lot of times, you know, I do try to ride it out.
Yeah, you try to ride it out, but I just feel.
And good. I'm at a point now, as I'm getting older, that I can't continue to do that to myself,
right?
Because it's not fixing anything for me to do that. Like, if anything, it's making it worse. Didi said that's why God says we have to be like a child because kids don't see disabilities. Right. Adults teach them that we are different. She said, my God, babies are the same way and will fight people if they say something about her. And Kay, being 3 years old, well, don't talk to my Gigi like that.
And I'm the same way about you, too.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You know, when you told me about what you went through and even now.
Yeah.
Like, you know, who said what?
And sometimes it's to a point where, you know, I am a person where if it don't feel right, I'm not doing it.
Right.
And I show up for people.
And you do.
I show up for people.
You do.
I do. I mean, that is God's gift to me, and I'll never stop showing up
for people. Even at your low.
Even at my lowest, I show up for people. And I don't ask for anything in return. The only thing that I ask for is some compassion and understanding. Because if there's a time where I can't show up for myself, if I can't find somebody to cover something for me in that moment, please just understand that it's not me not wanting to do something or trying to get out of doing something. It's never that because a rhyme and a reason.
I know you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? If you're going to do it, you'll push to do it.
Yeah.
But if it's something that, look, it's something going on.
Yeah. And, you know, like Trevita, that's my best friend. That's my Ace Boon Coon. We've been like this for forever. And we do bump heads, but we fix it. And
That's part of being friends.
I say
you're
that.
Bump heads, and you know what I'm saying? And when you fix it and y'all act like nothing happened, that's friendship. You know what I'm saying? I say that to say,
you know, when she was in college, she invited me to Friends and Family Day. I agreed to go. That morning, I called her and told her that I didn't think I was going to go. I wasn't feeling well. And it wasn't that I didn't want to go. My thing has always been, and people made me feel this way. And I'm finally getting to a point where I can't allow what people
think about me
to cover.
You was that way when we started dating.
Right. So I didn't want to go. Not because I didn't want to be a part of her world and what she's learning and things of that nature. I didn't want to be there and have an accident and people be looking at me trying to figure out, you know, what's wrong with her? Yeah. What, you know, why, you know.
When we go somewhere and walk and you like, you know, people, you think people are like watching you because of the way you walk.
And 9 times out of 10, they do.
Yeah.
I mean,
you had to overcome that too.
I had to overcome that because, you know, that's not for me. I mean, if they don't understand it and they don't question it, then, you know, I guess that's just for them to keep wondering about or whatever. But you went
with Sharita.
Yeah, I went and I had fun. Right. I enjoyed it. The teachers gave me work to do like they gave her work to do.
Right.
Have never been a person to put myself in situations where I feel trapped or scared or, and I'm not saying that she was going to allow somebody to do something to me. I know that's not how we move or whatever, but at the same time, I'm like, okay, I'm trying to focus on what's being taught. Was, you know, what I'm showing up for. But at the same time, I'm like, okay, how do I, you know, figure out where's the bathroom? How close is it?
And how can you maneuver yourself to get there
without
time?
Yeah. And then also having the thought of, okay, what do I continue to sit here if I do have an accident until everybody clears out and then I get up and go? Or, you know.
And that was another thing that we had to do when we go out.
Right.
You know, where we're at a restaurant, while we near a bathroom, was easy for you to, okay, I got to go.
Yeah.
That's why, you know, when we're at a restaurant, I make sure that, okay, we're at least, you know, not right at the bathroom.
Right, but close enough. I've missed out on a lot of opportunities. Well, not necessarily opportunities. Things that I would consider enjoyment because of what I deal with.
Right.
Like when we went to D.C. and we were going to see the monuments, as soon as we got to that subway station, tried to find a bathroom, found it. But they had a lock and chain on it.
Because
people were going in there shooting up.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I told you, you know, out of fairness, I'm like, you know, you haven't seen all this new stuff that was built up or whatever. You could go ahead. I was going to get on the thing and go back to the hotel. Right. He was like,
No.
I'm not allowing you to go back by yourself.
Right.
Or whatever.
DC, I wasn't going to let you go back there by yourself. And
But ultimately, at the end of the day, it's just embarrassing. I mean, and there's nothing that can be said to me or done for me to stop me from feeling embarrassed about what I can't change.
I almost chin checked the dude. So, dude, she all right. We got on the bus. We went back to the hotel.
Yeah.
You know, and hey.
But
I plan on going, taking you back. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But all in all,
when time permits.
Pride permits, and all in all, I wasn't going to let you do that by yourself.
Yeah.
As a husband.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? As a protector and as, a best friend that, okay, you're in this situation. Why would I do that? Why would I you go ahead. I'm going to go with my brothers and the kid.
Yeah.
Now I tell my brothers, look, Dej and Deontay with you.
Yeah.
Situation happened.
Yeah.
I got to go take Tonya back to the hotel.
You take
it
them.
It wouldn't have been, it wouldn't have been a man of me not to do that. That encounter with that dude, you never know
what his intentions were.
You know what I'm saying? He's like, look, man, hey, look, dude, look, back off. I got this.
Well, in closing, I just absolutely did it. No one truly knows unless you have walked that walk. Right. And a lot of people don't walk that walk. And so they don't know and they assume and they make up things in their head and, it's crazy. But in closing, in my closing, I just wanted to be transparent about what goes on with me. I'll be having surgery next month, doing a stem cell treatment, to see if that thing that doesn't go off that lets me know about going to the bathroom, they want to do a procedure that will stimulate that connection from that area to my brain and allow me to use the bathroom so I can have somewhat of some type of normalcy.
Right.
I do render your prayers and well wishes, whatever you believe in. Even if you wish bad upon me, I just need you to know God said no.
My thing of who would do that, but
I mean, people crazy. You never know. I want to thank you for coming on tonight, and I also want to thank you for riding with me through this for the last 22 years, because I know been a learning experience for you as well. I think
some people would fold.
Absolutely, I would fold.
Some people
would fold. I would fold if I mean. It ain't easy.
It's not.
It's not easy.
For worse.
And people don't get that. Yeah. We go head to head about some stuff and wind up not liking each other.
Right.
And I done walked out the door 50, 11 times. Right. And
all in all, that, when it comes down to something going on.
Right.
I'm the first one.
Right. I mean, you first in line and then my kids.
Yeah.
But again, I thank you all for tuning in to Delay But Not Deny. I'll be back in 2 weeks on Friday with my sister, sister in love, Reverend Yvonne Holt. And we're going to talk about her. She's a special education teacher and also a minister.
And my sister.
And his sister. So I'm going to have her on my show. So join me in 2 weeks. And I appreciate all the comments and questions and things of that nature. And if you didn't take away anything from this conversation tonight, please just don't bully people. Don't bully people, because you wouldn't want it to happened to you. And with that being said, I thank you for coming out. God bless you. Good night.
Tune in to Delay But Not Deny every second Monday and fourth Friday of each month. This is the show that you don't want to miss.